As I was getting ready to come in today, I said to a few folks that I had chills, and I realized I needed to clarify that. I don't have chills. I don't have a fever. I'm overwhelmed. So the chills are from being overwhelmed by being in your presence. So many of you have lost so much in this past 18 months. So many of you, as I hear the chatter of the baby in the room, have gained so much in these past 18 months. And so there's so much catching up to do, so many stories to tell, so much that you bring out of the love that you have that changes things. And I just need you to know, I'm going to say it a couple more times today, I love you all, and you are all very beautiful. I'm grateful for you every day of my life. I'm grateful today especially that our choir has returned, and you want to put hands together. You can't spread anything with that. I want you to welcome back the choir. Kevin, you've done an extraordinary job putting together incredible precautions and protocols with vaccinations and masks and all sorts of amazing things. And I'm grateful for your leadership through all of this time, but especially as you bring your loved ones in the choir back together. And Emily and Mark, you guided us along with Kevin through the summer. And Emily, as you stepped into the leadership role, I will forever be thankful and indebted to you. You brought us back into worship. Thank you. And I want to thank those who are on council and in the leadership of the church that did that as well. I want to thank my live stream buddies. Peter's in the other room this morning. Mike was earlier, and Janet has joined them. You need to know that between the deacons and the staff and the lay leadership, we wouldn't be here, and we wouldn't be safe, and we wouldn't be together if it wasn't for them. But I know that I'm supposed to preach now, so I'll stop. So thank you all. Would you join me in prayer? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each one of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our salvation. Amen. Robert Emmett Judge was born May 11, 1931, in Brooklyn, New York, the only son of immigrants from County Leitrim, Ireland. Born into the Great Depression to immigrant parents, his early years were hard, made much harder by his father's death when he was six. To support his family, young Robert went to work shining shoes in New York City's Penn Station at a very young age. When he finished at night at Penn Station, he would cross the street and visit St. Francis of Assisi Church. Seeing the Franciscan friars care for people, he later said, "I realized I didn't really care for material things. I knew then that I wanted to be a friar." The Franciscans eventually took him in. They educated him. As a Franciscan friar and a Catholic priest, Robert's name changed to Father Michael Fallon Judge. Michael spent his life serving the poor and the working class in Boston and then East Rutherford, New Jersey, but mostly in Brooklyn and then Manhattan. Father Michael was well known in New York for ministering to those who were homeless and hungry, recovering from alcoholism and drug addiction, people with AIDS, the sick, the injured, the grieving, the immigrants, gays and lesbians, and all those who were alienated in our society. He once gave his winter coat off his back to a homeless woman in the street, later saying, "She needed it more than me." And when he anointed a man dying of AIDS, the man asked him, "Do you think God hates me?" And Judge picked him up, held him in his arms, kissed him, and silently rocked him with this lullaby. "God loves you," he sang. As he cared for the poor, he also battled his own alcoholism. In 1978, thanks to Alcoholics Anonymous, Michael became clean and sober and then dedicated his life to support other alcoholics in their battle with the addiction. In addition, he battled the Catholic Church as he defended gay and lesbian sisters and brothers in New York through Dignity, Catholic organizations supporting the LGBTQ community, and many other LGBTQ ministries. Father Michael often asked, "Is there so much love in the world that we can afford to discriminate against any kind of love?" In his final 10 years of life, Father Michael Judge was a chaplain to the New York City Fire Department, where he offered encouragement and prayers at fires and rescues in hospitals and in the homes as he counseled firemen and their families, often working 16 hours a day. One firefighter said his whole ministry was about love. Michael loved the fire department and we loved him. It was as a firefighting chaplain that Father Michael died. In the North Tower lobby, in the World Trade Center, when the neighboring South Tower collapsed at 9:59 a.m. on September 11th, 2001. The collapse sent debris crashing through the North Tower lobby, killing many inside, including Father Michael Judge, whose cause of death was blunt force trauma. On 9/11, Father Michael Judge was designated as victim 0001, and thereby recognized as the first official victim of the attacks. Although we all know that others had been killed before him, including the crews and the passengers, the hijackers of those first three planes, and occupants of the towers and the Pentagon, he was the first certified fatality because he was the first body to be recovered and taken to the medical examiner. Just before the moment he was struck in the head and killed, Judge repeatedly was praying aloud in the lobby, "Jesus, please end this right now. God, please end this." When his body was extracted from the dust and the smoke and the glass, five men lifted Father Michael above their heads and carried him to the altar of St. Peter's Catholic Church, where they laid him at the foot of the altar. Following his death, news broke that Father Michael was gay and in a committed, loving relationship with Al Alvarado. To this day, there are those in the Catholic Church who want to bury this truth about his life and his love. Most others, and I think everyone here, as we celebrate 19 years of Open and Affirming, would agree that this is something to celebrate. And in fact, we believe that Father Michael Judge should be canonized as a true saint of the church, and that September 11th should forever be known as his Saints' Day. The beatification process for this Franciscan saint did begin earlier this year. Thanks be to God for Father Michael Fallon Judge, victim 0001. Although Michael Judge was victim 0001, the death toll on 9/11 would finally be known as 2,977 victims plus 19 Al-Qaeda terrorists. Among the dead that day were 340 New York City firefighters and another 72 New York City police officers. In addition, there were 25,000 people injured, and the entire nation and the entire world was turned upside down. Since September 11th, 2001, by what I've been able to gather, there are over 801,000 lives that have been lost in the major war zones of Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Iraq, including the deaths of 7,070 American soldiers and 3,010 American civilians, and another 56,400 wounded. Another 30,177 American soldiers have died by suicide since 9/11, four times the number of those who died in combat. More than 500,000 innocent civilian children, women, and men have died in the crossfire of war since that day. In addition, over 2,900 more first responders have died since 9/11 from cancers related to the toxic cleanup at Ground Zero. This war on terror has cost tens of trillions of dollars and as well has created many more millions of refugees of war in Afghanistan and Iraq and Pakistan who have fled for survival. And finally, let us remember, in the closing days of our final extraction from Afghanistan, 13 U.S. Marines and 60 Afghans were killed in a suicide bomb just 17 days ago in the Kabul airport. Sadly, victim 0001 has been joined by close to 1 million more souls since 8:46 a.m. on 9/11/2001, when the first plane flew into the North Tower of the World Trade Center complex. Each and every one of them was a child of God. Each and every one of them was beloved by God and someone else in this world. Evil unleashed pain on 9/11, and the pain that was unleashed in our land also affected and afflicted many more people of color and immigrants, and especially our Muslim brothers and sisters here and across the globe, who then and continuing to this day have faced hatred and disdain simply because they pray to God in the name of Allah. I have held them in their pain. I have wiped the tears from their faces. I have heard their cries for justice and fairness. They are good and faithful and loving people. They hurt too. In the words of the old African-American spiritual, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. And with that trembling, I ask us all to pause in silence this morning to remember in love victim 0001 and all who have been killed and wounded, grieved and stricken, sickened unto death, and forever impacted by September 11th, 2001. May we all remember this day and vow to end this evil madness in our world. Would you pause in silence with me? As September 11th was day one of the world's changing in many of our lives, September 12th was day two. Some of you remember September 12th, 2001, in this sanctuary. In the book First Sunday, Spiritual Responses to the 9/11 Attacks, published 10 years ago, my sermon from the 16th of September that year is included. And in the introduction to the sermon that I delivered that day are these words about September 12th. On September 12th, 2001, the city of Columbus gathered in an interfaith service in our sanctuary. More than 1,000 people came downtown that night to worship with people of all faiths and no faith at all. They came to weep, to hold on to each other. While a deep sense of evil, which had struck at the heart of our world 30 plus hours before, was present an even deeper sense of the light of God shone in the hearts of the 1,000 people gathered in our sanctuary that night. It was a moment of sheer epiphany as God's light overcame evil once again. It truly was a moment of sheer epiphany. I will never forget the highly enlightened Tibetan Buddhist who just happened to be in town. I don't know how God delivers Tibetan Buddhists when you need them most, but he was here. He came down the center aisle in his orange robe, and he walked up to me in the packed sanctuary, and he came within this. Remember when we used to get close to each other? He was this far away from me, and he looked in my eyes with a peaceful, oh my gosh, a peaceful presence and voice and said, "All will be well." And it was, for that moment, all was well. The children of God who had lost other children of God in our human family stayed into the night, praying and singing and loving one another. We reconnected with each other, knowing that it was the love of God and one another that would pull us through. A few days later, I read this prayer, this poem entitled "When the World Spins Crazy" by Walter Brueggemann. He prayed it at the lay school of the Pentateuch on September 17th that year. When the world spins crazy, spins wild and out of control, spins toward rage and hate and violence, spins beyond our wisdom and nearly beyond our faith, when the world spins in chaos as it does now among us, we are glad for sobering roots that provide ballast in the storm. So we thank you for our rootage in communities of faith, for our many fathers and mothers who have believed and trusted as firm witnesses to us, for their many stories of wonder, awe, and healing. We are glad this night in this company for this rootage of the text, for the daring testimony, for its deep commands, for its exuberant tales, because we know that as we probe deep into this text, clear to its bottom, we will find you hiding there. We will find you showing yourself there, speaking as you do, governing, healing, judging. And when we meet you hiddenly, we find the spin not so unnerving, because from you the world again has a chance for life and a sense of wholeness. We pray midst the spinning, not yet unnerved, but waiting and watching and listening. For you are the truth that contains all our spin. It is true that the rootage of the text that calls us once again, calls us clear to the bottom. The text calls us home. In Proverbs, wisdom, which is always portrayed as a female figure, cries out to us in distress from the depths of her sorrow. These ancient words, written over 2,500 years ago, cry out about human intransience and willfulness. Al did a beautiful job reading them. They are not the usual words about sin and injustice that she often brings. Rather, she cries about the particular offenses of, quote, being simple, of, quote, scoffing at people, of, quote, hating knowledge, and I would add 2,500 years later, and science. While God has placed graciousness and goodness at the disposal of Israel's women and men, and God has created a world of order and coherence and love, people respond with foolishness, she says. And the conspiracy theories that mock God and the beauty of God's ways in this world. Gee, I think she wrote this for the morning paper. I mean, it sounds like what we deal with now. I hear the echoes of Father Michael's final prayer and the words of wisdom's cry, "Jesus, please end this right now. God, please end this." The wisdom of Proverbs, the rootage of the text, always takes us deeper into the soil of the soul. Wisdom's final observation, as it always is positive and brings us to hope. Waywardness and complacency kill simpletons and fools because of God's truth. That's what she starts with. but it's God's truth that is secure and alert and anchored by women and men of faith who listen to God's promises and are at ease without the dread of disease, she says. James turns that soil of the soul even more when he reminds us that the tongue is a fire which can enlighten the world or burn it to the ground. So which will it be for you? Will you use your tongue on this day to disparage someone else? Will you use it to divide or to destroy? Will you use it for rumors and useless, damaging chatter? Or will you use your tongue to uplift, to alleviate pain, to celebrate God, to spread the joy of the good news of the love of God and Christ? Will your tongue heal or hurt? Will it unify or divide? Will it proclaim or poison? Do you see how the rootage takes us deeper into the text when the world spins crazy? To paraphrase Walter, when we probe the text clear to its bottom, we will find God hiding there. We will find God showing God's self there. We will find God speaking and governing and judging and healing at the deepest part of the text. And so we end with the deepest text of all, at the deepest part of the text. Here in Mark 8, 27 to 38, Jesus calls us to discipleship, which is nothing more than the deepest place of love that any of us will ever encounter. In discipleship, we learn to pick up his cross. We learn to follow him. In discipleship, we learn to lay down our lives for others. It was in this spirit of discipleship that hundreds of New York firefighters and police officers climbed the stairs into the fire of the Twin Towers on 9/11. They saved over 20,000 lives that day. And in the rubble from the crash of the towers, they saved another 11 in the days that followed. We sometimes forget there were 11 living souls in the rubble that they pulled to help. In the spirit of discipleship, Mark Bingham and the passengers of Flight 93 flew that plane to death and caused the plane to crash in an empty field just 2 miles from a school which had all of the children, grades K through 12, in that part of Somerset County in class. The FAA said at 563 miles an hour on impact, 2 seconds later, that school would have been gone and the town would have been destroyed. That's discipleship. That's heroism. When Jesus says, "Follow me," that's what it looks like when you look into the face of terror. Now, it's not like that for all of us every day. But we do see that God's texts take us deeper. We see that in the deep rootage of the text, we're called to deeper faithfulness and love. So what then do we say to all this? You may remember that was actually the title of the sermon. What the Apostle Paul tells us to say to all of this is simple. If God is for us, who can be against us? With this I close. Each morning, victim 0001, Father Michael Fallon Judge would rise and start his day in prayer on a prayer bench in his home, a prayer bench that you now find at the 9/11 Museum at the entrance to one of the shrines to the fallen. May this prayer guide you this morning and in the days ahead. He would pray, "Lord, take me where you want me to go. Let me meet who you want me to meet. Tell me what you want me to say. And keep me out of your way." Amen.